I'm James Taylor, and today we're going to look at modeling and texturing very simple eyeballs in Maya. I'm starting with a regular polygon sphere, and in my creation parameters, I want to adjust my subdivisions from 20 up to 48, and then I'll rotate it along its x-axis, just a 90-degree rotation, and I'm going to duplicate it next, so just Control-D to duplicate it, and I'm going to shrink that duplicate by half. And this duplicate is going to give us a reference for the size of our iris. So I want to zoom in so I can see that duplicate inside the original. And I'll select a bunch of faces along the front of my object so that they are about the same size as a duplicate. And we can see that that gives us kind of a proper sized iris on the front of the eyeball. Now before I go further, I have to adjust some settings on my scale tool. So I'll double click the scale tool, and then I want to find this prevent negative scale and just turn that off. And then I'm going to adjust my pivot point, basically scale those iris faces backwards into the eyeball. We are left with this disc shape on the front of our eyeball, and one problem that we'll have is we'll have a very sharp edge between the eyeball and the iris. And I'll select that edge, and then I'll use my bevel edge tool to just kind of soften it to create more of a rounded transition between the eyeball and that iris area. Next, I'm going to turn my attention to creating the pupil, and I'll just grab the vert that's in the very center and I'll pull it back. And I'll also pull some of the edge rows around it backwards as well to create more of a smooth divot. And just like I did for the edge of the iris, I'll select one of those outer rings on the pupil area and I'll bevel that to again create a nice smooth transition. And I should be left with a shape that looks like this. I've got a disc carved out of the eyeball that's my iris. I've got a pupil in there. So I'm gonna assign a new material to this and I'll use a blend. And I'll set it to a white color, but I don't wanna choose 100% white. I wanna add a little bit of pink to it. So that's the material for the sclera. Now I want to do the iris. An easy way to select it is to grab that vert in the center and then use our grow selection to grow right out to the edge of that bevel that we created. And I'll assign a new blend to that and I'll just darken it so that we can see very clearly the transition between the eyeball, the sclera, and the colored iris inside. Now with the same faces selected, I'm going to open up my UV editor. We'll see that we have just the regular default sphere UVs, and I'm gonna need to planar map the iris. So shift and right click and then planar map, and then I'll just move the rest of the UVs of the eyeball out of the way. And we need this sort of UV layout for the next step, which is material creation. So I'm gonna select the material for the iris, and in the color channel, I'm gonna plug in a ramp. And I just need to change that ramp's type to a circular ramp so I get a nice gradient. So I'll set my outer color to be the same color as the sclera, so that slightly pink color. And then I'll just adjust the position of the pins so that they sit right at the edge of that iris area so I get a nice smooth blend. Now I want to define the colors of the eye. So I'll add a blue pin in here and that'll be the base color. And I never want to go too saturated with the colors of the eye. They are natural colors, so we're always a bit desaturated and subdued. Now the outermost color is going to be pretty dark. It represents a shadow where the sclera overlaps the iris of the eye. And next to that, I'll add a brighter version of whatever color I've chosen, so a brighter blue. And then I'll add another bright blue color in the center of the eye so that right around the dark part of the pupil, I get a much, much brighter color. And so the overall effect is that I have the dark pupil in the center, a bright color right around that, and then it kind of fades out to this dark ring around the edge of the iris. And I want things shiny. So I'll lower the eccentricity on my blend and I'll turn the specular roll off all the way up. Now I get a nice shiny highlight. And this highlight is essential for making the eyeball look alive and interesting. Looking at it, I want to have a bit bigger pupil, so I'll just grab the faces in the center of the eye and I'll turn my soft mod on, just hit the B key, and I'll scale it up. And the bigger pupil just looks a bit more proportional. Okay, now let's add a cornea, the transparent shell around the outside of the eye. And I'll start it by building the same size sphere with the same number of subdivisions. The difference here is the front of my cornea object is going to come out. So I'll grab the vert that's at the pole of the eyeball there, and then I'll turn my soft modification on and just pull it a little bit forward. And that gives us that little bit of a lens that we need on the front of the eyeball. I'll grab a few edge rings and just scale them down to create a bit more of a lens effect popping out away from the overall sphere of the eyeball. And now I'm just going to assign a new blend material to it, and I'll up the transparency to 100%. Next, I'll crank up my specular roll-off and specularity to the maximum values, and I'll dial down the eccentricity a little bit. And this will give me a transparent, shiny sphere that's around the eyeball. And now I've got two sets of speculars, the one on the iris and the one on the cornea. And this will also help the eyeball feel alive, and it'll interact with the lights in the environment much more nicely. Okay, let's add a little bit more color to this sclera, the white part of the eye. I'm going to put a ramp on that, and I'm going to ramp from the color that we've already established for this sclera to a much more pink-red color at the back of the eyeball. And so this means that as the eyeball turns and it rotates, it'll look just a little bit more bloodshot. It'll feel like a little bit more like natural tissue without looking very exaggerated and overdone. And at this point, we've got a really basic eye that we could use, but if we want to step it up another level, we're going to need to add textures. So I'll open my UV editor again, and I'll select the faces of the iris. And then I'll go into the polygons menu and choose UV snapshot. And I'll choose a relatively high resolution, and I'll save this image out, and I'll use this as a basis for painting in my paint program. Here I'm going to use Photoshop, and when we switch over, we'll see that the image that was saved out is basically just a screenshot of our UVs, and now we can draw on top of that to create our texture. First thing I'll do is I'll just create a new layer, fill it with gray, and use that as an overlay layer. And now I'm going to start painting, and I need to use pressure-sensitive brushes. And in Photoshop, this means that shape dynamics is turned on. We can check that in our brush properties. And if we turn it off, we'll see that we don't get nice tapered strokes. And we want that taper on the ends of our brush to make things look a little bit more natural. So I'm going to use a black paintbrush, and I'll just start sketching in lines. And in general, I'll try to do curved lines. So big U shapes or big circular shapes. I'll vary the sizes, so some will be very big and then some will be very small. And I'll basically do half of the eyeball area so that half of it is filled up with these black lines. And then once I'm done filling it up, I'll just duplicate that layer and flip it over using the Edit, Transform, Rotate 180 and just reposition it on the opposite side. I also use the eraser to get rid of the center part of the line so that they're not overlapping the pupil. This isn't really strictly necessary. The next step is to create a new layer and to use white lines, and I'll do it in the exact same way that I created the black lines, so tiny little ovals and U-shape objects. If you're using a touch-sensitive tablet like the Wacom's, you can use two fingers to rotate the canvas around, and in this way makes it a lot easier to paint all the way around the circumference of the eye. Just a little tip for those of you with touch-sensitive tablets. And then when the painting is done, we duplicate it the exact same way that we did the black lines. Now, I'll duplicate both of those layers again, both the white and the black line layers. And with those duplicates, I'll go to my filter menu and choose blur and do a Gaussian blur and just do a small blur on both of those. So I have a blurred version of both the black and the white lines. And then I'll apply those as overlays over the background. And this just makes it look a little bit less hand-drawn and a little bit more organic. So I like to use the blur to just kind of make things fit together a bit better. And then when I'm done, I'll save it out and I'll jump back into Maya, and I want to open up the hyper shade, and I'll just graph the network of my iris material. So I just hold right click on the material and do graph network from the hyper shade, and that'll show me the network of my materials. And I need to add a new texture node because I'm going to plug in that Photoshop texture that I just added. So on the left there, 2D textures, and then just click file. And I'm going to need another node. So I'm going to click on other textures on the left here and then add a layered texture. And this is going to blend together the color that I've already created with the texture that I made in Photoshop. And I need to connect the out color from both the ramp and that new texture into my layered shader. So I can click and drag to connect one, and then I can click in the empty box to add another node to the layered shader. And now I can click and drag the second texture onto that new node so that both of my textures are connected to the layered texture now. And I can middle mouse drag those swatches in the layered texture to rearrange them. And the one that's closest to the left is on top, and the one that's closer to the right is on the bottom. It works a lot like Photoshop's layering system. Now I'll connect this layered texture to the diffuse channel, my color channel on my eyeball, and we should see our texture pop up because I've layered the texture on top of my ramp. And I need to adjust the blend mode the same way that I would adjust blend modes in Photoshop. And I'll click through and I'll check all the different options. So the one I'll end up using here is subtract. That one gives me the look that I'm going for. Now, if we look closely, we'll see that the lines that we've drawn are overlapping around the outside edges of the iris and also near the pupil in the center, and we want to fix that. To do this, I'll use a ramp to control the opacity of the texture, and the easiest way to do this is to just grab the ramp we're already using and duplicate it by hitting Control D, because we know it matches up the positions that we need, and I'll just recolor it. I'll use the existing pins and I'll just change the outside pins to black and the inside pins to white. And now I'll be able to use this to fade out that texture as it gets close to the edge of the iris and towards the pupil in the center. I'll jump back to the layered texture and now I need to plug this in. So what I'll do is I'll go to the layered texture, I'll select the texture, the iris texture that we created, and then I'll middle mouse drag that new ramp onto the alpha in the layered texture. So I want to drag it onto the word alpha. And now we'll see that it's controlling blending for the opacity of that texture so that I can adjust where the lines are towards the pupil and the outside of the iris by just moving the pins on the new black and white ramp that I've created. And then I'll play around with the positions of the pins. You'll see that I pull that white one towards the center, and it'll make that texture less opaque at the edges, but it'll blend things together more nicely. And when we look at it from far away, it'll work pretty well. So this ramp and this texture combo won't hold up to super close scrutiny, but it only took us a few minutes to create. So this is great for background characters or projects that have more stylized art direction style. The other great thing about this combo is it allows me to change the color of the eyes very easily without needing to regenerate new textures for each color. So all I have to do is go back into my original ramp, grab the color nodes that I have, and just start shifting them into other parts of the spectrum. So if I want to create green eyes, I just move it from blue over to green or maybe to yellow. We'll end up with new color combinations. It makes it really easy to create new eyes for each character that we're making. So that's it. That's how we put together Simple Eyes in Maya. It's just that easy. Any questions, don't hesitate to leave a comment. I'm James Taylor. As always, thanks for watching.